passer ma critique. Ouais, ça tu mets il y a moins c'est moins t'as pas de combien d'autres. Non, mais ça, il y a moins. Ok, c'est une encore les MSM 111. le management. Quand même. Okay, good afternoon, students. This is our second session of the day. I hope everyone is able to see what is on the what is being built. This is the fourth lecture of the course, which is Mathematical Methods 1, MSM 101 Mathematical Methods, one for first semester. So we are going to look this afternoon in the first 1 hour, we'll look at SATs, because it's a very short lecture. So from there then, we revert to what I said in the morning, that we are going to look at some questions from the tutorial sheet. So this is the structure of this lecture. The first part, we are going to look at basic definitions and examples of SATs. Then we'll look at rules of SATs. We'll look at multiplication, multiplying a SAT by a real number, rationalizing the denominator in a given SAT. Now, let's start with the definition. This is a lecture, not a topic, it's just a lecture, it's a continuation. Okay, the question is, in this lecture, we discuss properties involving SATs. So we are going to discuss properties that involve SATs. Now, the question that you need to ask yourself is, what is a SAT then? What is a SAT? Not SAT of being sad, not being unhappy. No, this is a mathematics SAT. It's a number. When is a number said to be a SAT? So a SAT is a square or nth root that cannot be expressed as a rational number. Any square root or any nth root can be the cube root of a given number, can be the square root of a given number, can be the fifth root of a given number, can be the hundredth root of a given number. Provided that number, you can't express it as a rational number or as a quotient of integers, then we call that number a SAT. If you can recall, under the sets of numbers, we talked about a prime number. The square root of any prime number is a SAT. So examples of SATs include, among others, there are a lot of them, the square root of 2, the square root of 7, the square root of 3, the square root of the cube root of 42, the square root of 110 are SATs. These are examples of SATs.
When you use your calculator, you find the square root of 2, it's non-terminating. In short, this is an irrational number. In short. So they cannot be evaluated directly. You can't evaluate them directly. They are irrational numbers, in short. They are irrational numbers. Now, such calculation usually arise in different calculations. You find that you are solving, in the process of solving, then they will, in the process of solving, you realize that you need to evaluate a sat. You find maybe you are given square root of 2 or square root of 7 over maybe some number, which is a sat. So these arise in different types of calculations that we can. Now, for example, if you use Pythagoras theorem to find hypotenuse of a right angle triangle with its adjacent sides given. This is just one of the examples. Now you want to find this side, now you are given these other two sides. You know, you are finding some, in the process of evaluating either the one of the adjacent side or the hypotenuse itself, you realize that at the end of it all, you are using the square root of the other value on the other side of the equal sign. So in the process, some of the square roots, you can't evaluate them directly. Instead, you are using the calculator. And after using the calculator, still, you use to round off, maybe to the nearest one decimal place, the nearest two decimal places, so just like that. You find this far answer that you have found, it's non-terminating, it continues going. Why? It's because it's a sat. I hope you are understanding. So now, I hope everyone is able to hear my voice. Okay, someone is saying you are fast, that means you are able to hear my voice. Okay, now, let's look at some rules that involve sats. The rules of sats. The rules of sats. Okay, now, generally, we have these are the three most important rules when working with sats. You need to remember them. Whenever you are working with sats, you need to remember these three important rules, namely the product rule. Whenever you multiply two sats, so the square root of A times the square root of B, provided the square root of A is a sat, the square root of B is a sat, this is just equal to, this is the same as the square root of A times B. The square root of A times the square root of B, what you're going to get is the square root of A times B. Again, the quotient rule. Under the quotient rule, the square root of A divided by the square root of B, which you can also write as the square root of A over the square root of B, this is the same as the square root of A divided by B. The square root of A divided by the square root of B, this is equal to the square root of A divided by B. Now, let's look at this one. I call it the scalar multiple and so or some rule, where you are talking of the scalar multiple and also the sum or difference rule. So this one, what it states is that a constant C multiplied to a sat plus or minus the constant D multiplied to a sat A, this is the same as we can post factor out the sat. There is prefactoring and post. You can post factor out the sat, and this will give us C plus or minus D multiplied by the square root of A multiplied by the side. Then, now, this, take note of this. It must carefully be noted that you should always remember that the square root of A plus or minus the square root of B, this is not the same as the square root of A plus or minus B. Oh, let me just take you back. Let me just take you back here, plus or minus. I think some of you maybe might get confused. Why is the side isn't there plus or minus? So what it is, for example, let me just give you an example. Let's forget about the minus. Let's blind ourselves from the minus. If we have C times the square root of A plus D times the square root of A, if you see the square root of A and the square root of A is common. So we can factor it out. So we can factor out the square root of A and go to remain with C plus D times the square root of A. Also, if we have C times the square root of A minus D times the square root of A, what we are going to get is C minus D times the square root of A. That's what this statement is just trying to tell you. So now, then you should take note that if I have the square root of A plus the square root of B, which are facts, this is not the same as the square root of A plus B. Or if I have the square root of A minus the square root of B, this is not the same as the square root of A minus B. The final answer that you're going to get will be totally different. Some examples on how we can evaluate facts. Let's look at some examples involving sides. Let's look at some examples Let's look at some examples involving sides. Example number two is just a simple example that is showing us how we can evaluate sides. When you're given this side, and then they will ask you to simplify it as much as possible. Simplifying it as much as possible. What they want you to rewrite it in such a way that you can't go any further. So simplify the following as much as possible using some or all of the three rules stated above. So we are simplifying this example number two. We are going to use the rules of SAT to simplify the given expression. Roman numeral number one, example two, Roman numeral number one is telling us evaluate the square root of 8 times the square root of 2. Both the square root of 8 and the square root of 2 are SATs. The next one, the square root of 78 over the square root of 6. Third, 11 times the square root of 5 minus 4 times the square root of 5. Number 4, 20 times, open bracket, the square root of 3 times the square root of 3 times the square root of 9, close bracket, minus 16 times the square root of, open bracket, the square root of 9 times the square root of 9, close bracket, over the square root of 8 plus the square root of 2. I know some of you are going to ask me, sir, is square root of 9 a sad? I'll leave that to you. Okay, now, let's look at number one. The square root of 8 times the square root of 2, this will give us the square root of 8 times 2. This will give us the square root of 8 times 2, which is going to give us the square root. Now, 8 times 2 is 16. And then the square root of 16 is 4. Part number two, and we are here, the square root of 78 divided by the square root of 6, this will give us the square root of 78 divided by 6, which will give us the square root of 13. Now, the square root of 13, you have put this value, this expression, in its simplest form such that you can't evaluate anymore. You've ended there, it's done. You can't go any further. Roman numeral number 3, 11 times the square root of 5 minus 4 times the square root of 5, this is just equal to, remember, rule number 3, this is because the square root of 5 is common, the third square root of 5 is common, we can post factor it out, and then we can have 11 minus, open bracket, 11 minus 4, close bracket, times the square root of 5, and 11 minus 4 to give us 7, times the square root of 5. Then we have evaluated this side, the value of these two sides. So basically, those rules helps us to evaluate sides, The three rules that you've seen, they usually help you to evaluate the sides, to simplify sides, and arrive at a very simplified result. Okay. Please try explain more. Okay, let's look at part 4. Part 4, which is the solution reflecting there. Under the question drew, I don't think if they are common. Are they common? Yeah, they are different sides. But sometimes if they are common, that means it's one, equal to one. In most cases, the question drew is trying to tell us that when the sides are different and then is this, then they are divided. So you follow those rules and they ask you to evaluate to simplify the final answer then. Okay, now let's look at this example. So this part is equal to, hello, when you use whatever is in the brackets, which is the square root of, which is 20 times, which is 20 times, open bracket, the square root of 3 times the square root of 3 times the square root of 9, close, we can use the product rule. So using the product rule, we are going to have the square root, which is this one, the square root of 3 times 3 times 9, minus. Again, 16 times the square root of 9 times the square root of 9, you can rewrite this, and it will become the square root of 9 times 9. Simplify, you should be able to simplify from this stage. From this stage then, you would say, the square root of 81, which is, and now we have simplified from this stage. Square root of 81 is common. We can post factor it out. Okay, this stage is just the same as this stage. We can post factor it out, and we have this 20 minus 16 times the square root of 81 over the square root of 16. Okay, so then 20 minus 16 is 4, the square root of 81. But the square root of 81 is 9, the square root of 16 is 4. 4 and 4, they will cancel, of which what you're going to remain with is equal to 9. So what you have done, you have simplified that side to its simplest form in such a way that you can't go further. Can the answer be written as plus or minus 9? Yes, though let's try to limit ourselves to what it depends to what you are dealing with, which topic are you dealing with, and where do you want to apply such kind of answers. Because if I'm dealing with distance, I don't need negative 9. There's no distance which is a negative. If I'm dealing with minus, I don't need to say negative 20 watts. There's nothing like that. So you put, you pick the positive value. So even in this scenario, let's try to maybe say, okay, we minimize on using the negative values. Let's concentrate on using the positive values. Yeah, we are going to use that such answers, especially when we start looking at quadratic equations, quadratic functions. Okay. Let's go to the next example, number three. So, if you recall from the first rule of sides above, so we can use these rules that you saw, you can use them in two different ways. The rules that you saw, the rules of sides can be used in different ways. How? Namely, where you can multiply sides, but also you can factorize sides. You can multiply and factorize sides. Okay, now, whenever you factorize sides, this can help you to simplify any complicated type of equation. Once you just factorize a given side, it will be able to help you to simplify any kind of complicated question. Okay, the example number three is just showing us on how we can simplify sides to its really simplest form. You reach at the point where you can't go any further. Let's look at the square root of 27. It's simple. Square root of 27, you can also write it as the square root of 9 times 3. We want to simplify it. They ask you to find the square root of 27. So the square root of 27 is the same as the square root of 9 times 3, because 27 is the same as 3 times 9. 9 times 3. And then, since we are on this stage, that means we are on the right hand side of the multiplication rule of sides. So we should write this as the way it's appearing on the left hand side of the rule. So this one under the multiplication rule is the same as the square root of 9 times the square root of 3. And the square root of 9 is the perfect, 9 is a perfect square, so the square root of 9 is 3. But the square root of 3 is a side. So this is 3 times the square root of 3. Then you have evaluated your answers. Yeah, the square root of 3 is approximately 5.2. Can you say 3 times the square root of 3? You're going to get the same answer. You say 3. Now, you are saying the square root of 27 is approximately, you are using the word approximately 5.2. Because you have used the calculator to calculate that. Suppose you don't have a calculator. What are you going to do? And I'll ask you to evaluate this. So that's the situation you need to find yourself in. Remember, no calculators in this course. Even in second, next semester, no calculators. All questions are questions that you can solve, that you need to think and then you solve. Okay. Alright, if you didn't use a calculator, then that's good. But it's an approximation, yes. Okay. Now, so when you are faced with thirds, look to see whether the third can be factorized using square numbers. You have the third that you have been given. Then you look at the third. Is it possible that I can factorize this third, especially whatever is within the third, into some perfect squares with non-perfect squares? Are you able to factorize using square numbers or rather using perfect squares? If you look at 27, I was able to factorize it using the square number 9, the perfect square 9 with respect to 3. Square numbers such that 4, 9, 16, 25, 36, 49, 64, and so on and so forth, as we did in example number 3. So just like we did in example number 3. There are questions that you always be given. The questions that you always be given in the end of my exam, I'll be able to show you such kind of questions, I think, in the examples that are coming down. So you should be able to notice that, okay, here I can factorize this side as square numbers with another side. So there are some sides that you find after factorizing them, they simplify to very simplified form that you can't factorize further, just like the way we did in example number 3. So now, from this part, then let's go to the next part. You know, we've looked at examples concerning sides and some basic definitions and examples. Now let's look at multiplying a side by a rational number. Multiplying a side by a real number. Now let's do this. Any real number like 3, 7, 49 can be expressed as a root by remembering that, you know, any real number that you know in the fraternity of mathematics, you can express it as a root by using the fact that A is the same as the square root of A squared. For example, 7 is the same as the square root of 7 squared. I mean, the square root of the square of 7. 24 is the same as the square root of the square of 24. So, for example, we can write 7 as, so you can write 7, you can write it the way it appears. Like, 7 is the same as the square root of the square of 7, but the square of 7 is 49. So, 7 is the same as the square root of the square of 7, which is just the same as the square root of 49. So, the value, the quantity of these numbers is the same when, if we don't consider the negative. So the quantity 7 and the square root of 47, 49 is the same value. This means that we can multiply a side by a real number. First, by expressing the real number as a root, you can multiply this side by a real number. How can you do it? You first express the real number as a root. From there, then you use the rules of sides. You are done. You use the rules of sides. Now, a lot of students get confused with this. This is where now it gets tied up. Look, do not get confused and write an incorrect statement like this one, the square root of 7 times the square root of 7, then you write is equal to 49. That is wrong already. That is totally wrong. So don't confuse yourself with the way these signs are being written. A lot of students make mistakes. They confuse this statement with this one. They start writing different things. Square root of 7 times square root of 7 is the same as the square root of 49. Not 49. No. Okay, now we are given this question. For example number 4 is trying to tell us how sides you can multiply sides by real numbers and things. Just trying to clarify what I'm from measuring. So simplify the following as much as possible. Simplify the following as much as possible. You bring it to a situation where you can't go further. Okay, now the square root of 512 minus 15 times the square root of 2. The second one, this 5 times the square root of 75 plus 2 times the square root of 3. 1. Roman numeral 1 solution. Let's look at the solution, Roman numeral number 1. The square root of 512 minus the square root of 2. You know, 512 is the same as 2 times 256. 2 multiplied by 256. So the square root of 512 is the same as the square root of 2 times 256 minus 15 times the square root of 2. What is the instance here? The instance here is we want to write this square root of 512 as the square root as some real number multiplied to the square root of 2. We want to write it in that format. So now, this This piece gives us this. And using the product through here, using the product through here, this is the same as the square root of 256 times the square root of 2. Then, using rule number 3 of SATs, which involves the multiple factor, the multiple product, and the sum rule, or the difference rule, this, the square root, first of all, the square root of 256 is equal to 16. Then using that rule, we can factor out this post factor, the square root of 2, which we are supposed to have, which we can have 16, open bracket, 16 minus 15, close bracket, times the square root of 2, of which 15 times minus 15 to give us 1, and then 1 times the square root of 2 to give us the square root of 2. So this expression has been reduced to this format. The next one, 5 times the square root of 75 plus 2 times the square root of 3, 75 is the same as 25 by 3. So using the product rule on this expression, the square root of 25 times 3, we are going to get 5 times the square root of 25 times the square root of 3 plus 2 times the square root of 3. When we see the square root of 25, which is 5, so we're going to have 5 times 5 multiplied by the square root of 3 plus the 2 times the square root of 3, and then 5 by 5, using them, we are going to get 25 times the square root of 3 plus the 2 times the square root of 3. So these two gives us 27 times the square root of 3. Then you are done. This is where an exam questions comes from. One or two questions you find in an exam. Rationalizing the denominator. What is to rationalize? Rationalizing the denominator. So, and what we are learning now, especially under this part number 4, where you are rationalizing the denominator, please listen carefully. Something that you're doing, please try to remember. Because what I'm explaining here, you are going to use this for the rest of your learning. Third year, fourth year, fifth year, whichever year, engineering, mathematics, whatever you're learning, you're going to use this type of solving. No one will tell you in an exam, rationalize the denominator. But you are supposed to know, to see, whenever you are given a question, that I'm supposed to rationalize the denominator. Or there are times when you rationalize the denominator, but in this scenario, we'll be dealing with the situations where we're rationalizing the denominator. So you're also going to do calculus. When you're finding limits, you will be having a situation where you're rationalizing the denominator or numerator so that you can find your limit can be found directly. In other courses, you'll be doing that most of the time. You'll be doing complex numbers. Under complex numbers also, you'll be applying the same idea. Though there they tell you, we say it conjugate. So as of now, just look at rationalizing. So when can you rationalize the denominator? Basically, this only happens. You are given this expression with SATs in the denominator. If you look at this expression and then you have SATs in the denominator, so to eliminate the SATs which are in the denominator, that means you rationalize the denominator. What do you mean by rationalizing? This is how we do it. Okay, when dealing with expressions where SATs appear in the denominator, it is normal practice to eliminate all SATs in the denominator where possible. So you eliminate all SATs. This is called rationalizing the denominator. So you rationalize the denominator so that you can eliminate anything to do with SATs in the denominator. Okay, now, there are three components here that you're going to look at. Though in short, I call them, there are two. The first one and the second one. Then the second one has been split into two. Okay, now, expressions of the form 1 over square root of 2. This is not really, this is just, we are trying to give you an idea how you can rationalize the denominator, given that you have this expression where you have a sign in the denominator. You can have any number apart from 1 here. You can have any type of expression in the numerator apart from 1. But in the denominator, you have something like this. So, in this scenario, you are going to multiply. What you should do to remove the sign which is in the denominator, you are going to multiply both the numerator and the denominator. Remember, both the numerator and the denominator by the sign itself. How is this going to look like? Give it now. 1 over the square root of A, this is the same as 1 over the square root of A times the square root of A over the square root of A. Remember, there is nothing that you have done here. There is nothing that you have done here. This expression that you are seeing, 1 over the square root of A times the square root of A over the square root of A, is the same as 1 over the square root of A. So the quantitiness, this value is the same as this value. So this thing is going to give us, so it will be 1 times the square root of A, which will give us the square root of A. Then the square root of A times the square root of A, this is going to give us A. The square root of A times the square root of A is equal to A. Because the square root, according to those signs that we're doing, the square root, according to the multiplication rule of signs, the square root of A times the square root of A, which is in the denominator, this is the same as the square root of A times A. So which is equal to the square root of the square of A. And the square root of the square of A, according, if you remember, there's somewhere where we did this property, multiplying a sign by a rational number, and also under where we simplified the square root of 27, if you recall, this means the square root of the square of A is equal to A. So what have we done here? This number now is in standard form. This expression is clean because in the denominator we have removed everything to do with signs. So you have simplified this expression. Expression number 2 is a situation where you of the is a situation of the type 1 over b plus or minus the square root of a, where in the expression now here okay, so what you are saying here, if the expression is so from this we there are two, this is 2 in 1, so I'm trying now to break it. If the expression is in the form a, which is 1 over b plus the square root of a, if this is the expression that you have, and then they are asking you to simplify it, so you multiply the numerator and the denominator by, this is now, in complex numbers, you're going to conjugate. You multiply both the numerator and the denominator by b minus the square root of a. Here, and what you have in the denominator is b plus the square root of a. So for you to get rid of this sign, to get rid of the sign in the denominator, what you need to do is you need to multiply both the numerator and the denominator by b minus the square root of a. Once you do that, this means you're going to eliminate whatever signs you have in the denominator, which is giving us 1 over b plus the square root of a times b minus the square root of a over b minus the square root of a. Remember, this expression, which is b minus square root of a over b minus square root of a, is 1. So there's nothing that you have done. You're just trying to rewrite it in some other form, apart from the way it has been given. So, this will give us, when you simplify, you do the multiplication and simplification, what you're going to get is b minus the square root of a over b squared plus a. B squared plus a is not a sign. This is just a real number. Next, if our expression is in the form, if our expression is in the form 1 over b minus square root of a, this means now, look how the denominator has been given. The denominator is b minus the square root of a, so it's a sign. It's in form of a sign. So there's a sign which is appearing in the denominator. So we need to get rid of it. So this means, because it's b minus a, that means we are going to multiply both the numerator and the denominator by b plus the square root of a. which is the one is reaching the 110 down here. So at the end of it all, when we simplify, what we're going to get is b plus the square root of a over b squared plus a. So in general, to rationalize the denominator of 1 over a square root of b plus or minus c square root of d, we multiply numerator and the denominator by a square root of times square root of b plus or minus a times square root of d. Oh, sorry, it was supposed to be plus o. This is a times the square root of b minus or plus. You switch, you change the sides. C times the square root of d. Okay, now let's look at some examples that involves the same signs we are talking about, that involves this scenario of rationalizing the denominator. Let's look at some examples that involves the rationalizing of the denominator. Okay. Yeah, we are supposed to have a minus b here. That's not it, so it's just some type. Okay. Let's go to this example. Basically, they are telling us to say, rationalize the denominator in the following expression. Rationalize the denominator in the following expressions. The first one is 3 times the square root of 5 over 2 times the square root of 6. The second one, 10 divided by the square root of 3 minus 1. 3, 2 times the square root of 3 plus the square root of 2 over 3 times the square root of 2 plus the square root of 3. The first one is this. 3 times the square root of 5 over 2 times the square root of 6, because we have a third square root of 6 in the denominator, we should eliminate it by multiplying both the numerator and the denominator by the square root of 6. In this case, you can also multiply. In this scenario, you can try that. I challenge you to try that. You can also multiply both the numerator and the denominator by 2 times the square root of 6. You can also do that. Yeah, I think it's recorded, yes. So you can also try to do that. So now, and then you say 2 times, this will give us, now, but then 2 times the square root of 6 times the square root of 6, remember the square root of 6 times the square root of 6 is equal to just 6. And then we have 3 times the square root of 5 times the square root of 6. But then 5 times the square root of 6 according to SATs, this is the same as 3 times the square root of 13 over 12. Which 3 into 3 over the square root of 30 is square root of 30. Then into 12 is 4. The question that you can ask yourself is, can we write 30 as a product of squares? What squares? Think of 4, 9, 16, 25. Can we write 30 as a product of one of the squares with some other number, which is... not possible, so as such we'll leave it there. That is our final answer. So we have simplified this expression to its simplest form. The next one is number 2, 10 divided by the square root of 3 minus 1. So remember, according to this, what kind of formation that we have here? We have property number 2, part B. We have this property, this kind of a property. This is a property that we have in there. So now, in this scenario, we can multiply both the numerator and the denominator by square root of 3 plus 1. We can multiply both the numerator and the denominator by square root of 3 plus 1, which is this part. Now,
when you multiply 10 by square root of 3 plus 1, which is giving us this, but then in the denominator, square root of 3 minus 1 multiplied by square root of 3 plus 1, this is more or less like a difference of two squares. We are going to have 3 minus 1. And 3 minus 1, it will give us 2. Then there is, in the numerator, we have a 10. So 2 into 2, 1, 2 into 10, 5. So in generally, the final answer will be 5 times square root of 3 plus 1. And this is in its simplest form. There's nothing else that you can do here to simplify this. This is the end of the simplification. The next one. The next one. The next one is for the case, for this case, we can rationalize the denominator by multiplying both the numerator and denominator by, now if you see here, in the denominator, what we have is 3 times the square root of 2 plus the square root of 3. So by rationalizing the denominator, that means we multiply both the numerator and the denominator by square root of 3, or 3 times the square root of 2 minus the square root of 3. As such, when we do the simplification, so this value is the same as this value here. There's nothing that you have done. It's like you have just changed its appearance, but the quantityness is the same. The value is the same. So now we are going to have both the numerator and the denominator, you multiply it with 3 times the square root of 2 minus square root of 3, which is this part. And then when you do the simplification, square root of 2 times square root of 3 times, you know multiplication you did in algebra about multiplication, so you understand all those things. So you multiply this by that, plus minus this by that, and then plus this by this, this by that. Even in the denominator, you follow the same routine. But in the denominator, you can also use the difference of two squares method. The difference of two squares, you can also arrive at a very tangible answer. So, Mama. Hello? Okay, so this is how when you simplify in the numerator, you arrive at this, in the denominator you arrive at this, then you simplify further, you come up with what is down here. Simplifying further, you arrive at 5 times the square root of 6 minus 6 plus 6, which will reduce to the square root of 6 over 3. Then you are done with your question. I don't know. Someone is saying the question doesn't have a square. Okay. So let's look at this last example of this lecture. This last example of the lecture on SATs. And this is a 14:47. Like I said, just 1 hour. Okay, now if you look at this example, what this example is telling us is express
the square root of 2 plus 1 over the square root of 2 minus 1 in the form A times the square root of 2 plus B, where A and B are integers, and hence state the values of A and B. Now, the way this expression has been written, at times we say it's not in standard form. Why? Because we're able to see sats in the denominator. So we should be able to eliminate the sats for us to write it in the form A times the square root of 2 plus B. Now, these are the type of exam questions that usually comes. We can have such kind of a question which is related to this question in an exam. So, and you know, because you have different types of topics and then they give you this so simple question as a sweet course in an exam, you find you black out and forget what you are reading. So what you need to do is you need to be confident in yourself when you're solving questions in mathematics and also understand where that question is coming from and which topic. That's like when you remember all these things that you do in your everyday life. So you need to always, whenever you look at a question, you should be able to extract from your memory where that question is coming from. Not just from there, just the question has started, so you need to know which topic is this question coming from. And in that topic, which section of the topic or chapter, which chapter, which section, and which subsection or which subtopic is it coming from. Then from there, what type of questions are being asked in that scenario, in that subtopic. So you like sequence them in that manner, and then you see that the end of it all, when you're solving, will be so clear and all the answers will be correct. Okay, now let's look at this last example of this lecture four. So now you see, yeah, we have this question that has been given, and then they want us to write it in this form. The possible way you can handle this question is by rationalizing the denominator. That's all. Once you rationalize the denominator, you are done. If you are going to rationalize the numerator, you know, I say sometimes you can rationalize the numerator depending on how the question has been phrased. But once you rationalize the numerator, that means you are going to, at the end of your answer, you are going to have a sat in the denominator, which is not also acceptable. So that means you have to redo again the weight. You rationalize again. Then you continue repeating yourself and rotating and rotating. So you need to know to understand, you're given a question, which part should I rationalize when you have such kind of a scenario? Okay, now let's look at this question, the solution. So the only possible way to reduce it to this form is by rationalizing the denominator. So when you rationalize the denominator, what we're going to get is, so the square root of 2 plus 1 over the square root of 2 minus 1. So we're going to multiply the denominator and the numerator by the square root of 2 plus 1. So multiplying the square root of 2 plus 1. Now if you look in the denominator, this is more or less like a difference of two squares. So this is the same as the square of the square root of 2 minus the square of 1. So to give us 2 minus 1. Then in the denominator, you're going to have the square root of 2 times the square root of 2 to give us 2. The square root of 2 times 1 to give us the square root of 2, then 1 times the square root of 2 to give us the square root of 2, then 1 times 1 to give us 1. Now we collect the like terms, just like though we do for real numbers. You're going to have 2 plus 1, which will give us a 3, and then the square root of 2 plus the square root of 2. This is using the property number 3 of the rules of sats to give us 2 times the square root of 2. Now, 2 minus 1 is 1. So 3 plus the square root of 3 plus 2 times the square root of 2 is divided by 1 is just 3 plus 2 times the square root of 2. Now this expression, you can also write it, since they want you to write it in this form, this one is the same as, you can start with 2 times the square root of 2 plus 3. So in this scenario, our A is equal to 2, our B is equal to 3. Then you get your maximum and then you smile and say, okay, I've got what I need to get. So this is about size. And then there are some references where you can refer to get such question, more questions about size. This is the end of lecture number 4. Thank you for your time, attention, and listening. So the next class says will be for math. There will be next week, of which we are going to look at different components. So when you come next week, we are going to look at functions. We are going to start functions. Next week we are going to look at functions, and then in the second week of your being in school, we are going to look at quadratic functions. We are going to look at functions in general, the normal functions, how to sketch functions, the types of functions. Then from there, we're going to look at quadratic functions according to the way the structure is. Then we're going to look at polynomials, then look at logarithmic functions. Then the last topics will be, what is this? We're going to look at binomial expansions and rational numbers. Then we'll end there, maybe that will be in week. For 5, we're going to look at trigonometric functions and these other functions. Which my colleague will take up from there. Okay, have a nice day. We'll meet next week.